The vision that we started with 4 years ago could not be more timely today, because the world understands how critical it is for us to focus on our immune health because of its impact on our individual health and our economy, our national security, and almost every aspect of our life. Hi, my name is Amro Albana. I am the co-founder, chairman, and CEO of Aditext. Everybody is keenly aware of how critical our immune system is. It plays a key role, of course, in our personal health, in the economy, global economy. We've all seen what COVID has done to the global economy and national security. And moving forward, we have to take a different approach, fundamentally different approach to how we look at our immune health and our immune system. And that cohesive approach, that 360 view of our immune health, begins by addressing the threats, understanding the threats, being, you know, be it viruses or bacteria, as well as developing new technologies to deactivate those threats to our immune system. So that's only one side of the equation. The second side of the equation is our immune system itself. And we also have to do a couple things. In order for us, and I mean that collectively, in order for us to be able to develop effective therapeutics focused on the immune system, we must begin by understanding the immune system and decoding the immune system so we can be knowledgeable of its dynamic status. See, our immune system is not static. It is constantly changing. And with Aditext, we develop a platform called Aditext Core that will enable us to begin decoding the immune system to understand its dynamic status and its level of readiness to address such threats. In addition, we're developing new therapeutics, new class of therapeutics, capable or designed to modulate the immune system up or down, depending on the applications. And we believe by taking this approach, it will open up a whole new set of opportunities that we have not imagined before to advance the health of our immune system by addressing the threat side as well as the immune side of the equation. This new vision of how we look at our immune health could potentially address areas that we've never been able to do before. Just imagine if we get to the point where we understand with very high specificity and very high sensitivity how our immune system is reacting to a transplanted organ. And understanding that dynamic status could lead us into the ability of modulating the immune system to make it recognize a transplanted organ as self. So think about the implications. If we get to the point where we can retrain our immune system to make it recognize a transplanted organ as self, think about the implications and what it would do for the waiting list and what it would do for people that are waiting on an organ to be donated. And especially think about those patients that already have a transplanted organ and really giving them the opportunity to live a more normal life with that transplanted organ that they receive. As I discussed earlier, there are really two sides of this equation: the pathogen side, the threat side, and then the immune system side. As we begin to better understand the potential threats to our immune system and to our health in general, as we begin to develop technologies that can rapidly detect those threats, we will be much better positioned as a society to address those threats and deactivate those threats. So it is key, as we begin to implement this vision of the new age of immunity, to focus on the pathogen side, to focus on the threat side, and to develop new technologies that could rapidly detect the threats, beginning to understand the dynamic status of our immune system, beginning to understand what our immune system is doing at any given time, and the capability of modulating the immune system will open up new opportunities that have not been imagined before. When you look at modulating the immune system, whether it's modulating the immune system up to make it better recognize threats like cancer, or modulating the immune system down to make it accept a transplanted organ as self, to make it address autoimmune diseases and prevent it from attacking our own cells and tissues, like multiple sclerosis, type 1 diabetes, psoriasis, and many other autoimmune diseases, and allergies, severe allergies where our immune system is overreacting to an external substance or an allergen. So modulating the immune system can only be possible by decoding the immune system. And the opportunities that both together combined will open up new opportunities that the world could not imagine before. Given the vision that we have, the new age of immunity, and accelerating towards that vision for better immune health and better overall health, Aditxt is taking deliberate steps to implementing every aspect of that vision, beginning with rapid detection of threats, developing new technologies to deactivate the threat to our immune system, decoding the immune system to understand its dynamic status and monitoring the immune system, and finally modulating the immune system. And we believe all four segments of Aditxt combined will position Aditxt very uniquely. We will begin to show how it really truly requires a multidisciplined company to effectively develop and implement technologies and new biotechnologies to implement this new vision for approaching our immune health. Given the vision of the new age of immunity, and given the size and the scale of the challenge ahead of us, humanity, we believe that it will require a different way of thinking, a different approach to address the problem. And we believe that creating an ecosystem, Aditxt is a company, but we also look at it as an ecosystem that brings together the best of the best, research institutions, other companies, other partners from all over the world that share our mission, that share our vision, and coming together in this ecosystem to deliver on that core vision, which is accelerating humanities towards the age of immunity, focusing on the four cornerstones of that vision: the detection of pathogens, the deactivation of those threats, decoding our immune system, and finally modulating our immune system. And we truly believe a collaborative approach to the problem is the only way we can scale our innovations. Right now, Aditxt could not be better positioned to address the new age of immunity and every aspect of that vision. We have technologies that detect pathogens such as COVID-19, and we are continuing to look and seek new technologies for rapid detection of current and future threats. We are working with a partner, as we announced recently, AI Pharma, working on antiviral technologies to deactivate such threats. We have a platform called Aditxt Core, focused on decoding and understanding the dynamic status of our immune system. And we launched Aditxt Core for COVID-19 as the initial applications, and more applications to follow. And finally, our immune modulation platform, where we designed it to modulate the immune system up or down, and beginning with psoriasis as our first application in autoimmunity, pending regulatory approval, we are on target to begin clinical trials late 2022. So if you look at Aditxt and you look at every aspect of our business and what we bring together, we could not be better positioned to achieve our vision and our mission focused on the improvement of the immune health.
Almost 100,000 women in just the United States die of breast, ovarian, and endometrial cancer per year. So for us, the problem is clear. That 100,000 number has to be changed. Hi, I'm Martin Lehr, CEO of Context Therapeutics. Context is focused on women's oncology, meaning breast, ovarian, and endometrial cancer. The problem that we seek to address within women's oncology is the fact that while treatments are available for breast, ovarian, and endometrial cancer, the durability and effect of those treatments over time often weakens. And so there's a clear unmet need for new treatments to either enhance the therapeutic activity of those drugs that are already approved, or to provide totally novel therapies to further enhance the clinical toolkit of clinicians to provide better outcomes for patients. And better outcomes is not just the efficacy of one's drug, but also the tolerability. There's unfortunately a lot of women out there who are dealing with both primary disease. So when the disease is first diagnosed, and in the United States, that's over 250,000 breast cancer patients alone. And then once they have metastatic disease, meaning that the cancer has moved on from the primary site to a distant organ. At that point, there unfortunately are no cures. And almost 100,000 women in just the United States die of breast, ovarian, and endometrial cancer per year. So for us, the problem is clear. That 100,000 number has to be changed. The way that we are playing a part in changing that is developing a pipeline of investigational therapies to treat breast, ovarian, and endometrial cancer. They range from our most advanced program, which is a oral progesterone receptor antagonist that is the subject of 4 ongoing clinical trials, 2 breast cancer trials, 1 endometrial, and 1 trial in a rare form of ovarian cancer called granulosa cell tumors. And then we have an investigational product that's in preclinical development that combines precision medicine, which is the specific targeting of a tumor, and immunotherapy, which is getting the immune system to attack the tumor. And so that modality is a bispecific antibody targeting claudin-6 and a protein on an immune cell called CD3. We're really excited about both of our programs, our progesterone receptor antagonist and our claudin-6 bispecific. And we think that these programs, if successful in their development, life will hopefully halt the growth of cancer for women, potentially decrease the size of the tumor, so actually impact and halt the growth of the tumor, and do all that while enabling women to play with their kids, play with their grandkids, play tennis, not lose their hair, not have significant skin discoloration, all things that are commonly associated with current treatments too. That are being used for those cancers. So for us, the problem and solution is clear. We want to decrease the mortality associated with female cancers, and we want to develop novel treatments to bend that mortality curve. And that's what excites all of us who are involved with Context Therapeutics and what gets us up in the morning to work every day.
You have 7,000 rare diseases. 95% don't have an approved treatment today, and worldwide, this impacts over 400 million patients. Half of those are children. This is a huge therapeutic unmet need. Hi, my name is Tim Gilliams. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Helix. Helix is a tech platform company focused on accelerating treatments for rare diseases. Do this at scale and in a different way. It's a super exciting time for the company. We're going through our growth phase. We have 120 employees today. It's a multidisciplinary team at the intersection of tech and bio. Our tech platform has been validated. We launched over 20 therapeutic programs, received approval from the FDA to start a phase 2A clinical trial that's in Fragile X. It's a $1 billion market and a huge milestone for the company, but also a really important point for patients and families who have Fragile X syndrome. So we're super excited about those developments, and we'd love to tell you more about it. In 2014, when I finished my PhD, I met my co-founder and executive chairman, David Brown. I was doing a PhD in biophysics at Cambridge University. I was deeply passionate about applying machine learning to drug discovery. And Dave, who was previously global head of drug discovery at Roche and co-inventor of Viagra, had a really similar excitement about what was possible with machine learning in drug discovery today. But where it really, you know, came together is when Dave and myself met a rare disease parent called Nick Zero. Nick, who lives in Cambridge, has two children with an ultra rare disease called black bone disease. There were no treatments available. And at the time, Nick was on a mission to try and find a treatment for his children. And he was trying to repurpose an existing drug to do that, which ended up being hugely successful. So that's now been approved by the EMA as a therapy. And the project from a medical perspective was led by our chief medical officer, Tony Hall, who did this in an incredibly cost-effective manner. But back in 2014, Dave and myself realized that Nick wasn't alone. You have 7,000 rare diseases, 95% don't have an approved treatment today, and worldwide, this impacts over 400 million patients. Half of those are children. This is a huge therapeutic unmet need. And we realized that technology could really help do this at a different scale, at a different speed, at a different cost basis. And so our technology platform allows us to do this 3 to 5 times faster, cheaper, and with a higher likelihood of success. And so we focused on building the next generation of biotechs with a 50 to 100 billion potential. We think this is a really huge opportunity here. And it's important to really break down first what broke the traditional pharma industry. So right now, today, you have a 95% failure rate. It costs $2 to $3 billion per drug, per new drug to market. And it takes 10 to 15 years on average. And a big component of that is the drug discovery paradigm that was applied. It was called target-based drug discovery. And it was overly simple. It was based on one disease, one target, one drug. And actually, disease biology is much more complicated than that. We have 22,000 genes who get upregulated, downregulated, more than 8,000 metabolic reactions. And so for most complex diseases, you will need an approach that is not based on a single target and a single drug activity. And so we developed a different approach. And when we say we're pioneering the next generation of drug discovery, what we mean is we've developed an approach that is going beyond making incremental improvements to the current broken target-based drug discovery paradigm. And so our technology platform allows us to first understand disease biology in a different way, beyond a single target or a single mechanism. And we're able to do that by making the most of this new biological data, your genome, transcriptome, proteome, metabolome, etc. And by applying machine learning to that, we're able to discover first these new disease mechanisms and then match the right treatments to that in a much more combinatorial way based on polypharmacology and drug combinations. We believe we will have a much higher likelihood of success by doing so, because the paradigm behind it is actually more complete. The type of methods we use is a combination of graph-based prediction methods and omic-based prediction methods. And importantly, well, our approach has shown to work and shown to be scalable across different diseases and therapeutic areas. So today we've launched 21 programs. We've discovered more than 53 novel disease mechanisms with drug candidates. Our lead program on Fragile X received IND approval by the FDA. That's going to be a clinical trial based on combination therapy. So we're going to test three different drugs and mode of actions. This has never been tried before on Fragile X, and we believe we have a really high likelihood of success. It's also a $1 billion market, so we're really excited about those developments. We're continuing to grow our therapeutic pipeline. The future NPV of the programs we've started today already projects more than a $50 billion potential. And so we're focused on building a large de-risk therapeutic pipeline with multiple shots on goal and the opportunity for patients and the commercial opportunity is really significant. And we are thanking you for your attention and interest. And so we're currently raising our Series C round to accelerate our growth. If you'd like to hear more about it, please don't hesitate to be in touch. My email is tim@helix.io. Thank you.
We represent in a way a balancing act in the industry. We look at trying to solve some of these inefficiencies to give life to drugs that otherwise would not be economic and would not see the light of day. Hello, I'm James Garner. I'm the chief executive of Kazia Therapeutics. I want to talk today about the problem of innovation in the pharmaceutical industry. We're really an industry of two different kinds of companies. On the one hand, we have smaller biotech companies, which take a piece of their own proprietary intellectual property. They have their own scientists, their own laboratories, and they work hard over many years trying to take that intellectual property all the way to patients, all the way to a commercial pharmaceutical product. And there are many companies that have been incredibly successful in doing that, but there's also many that have stumbled along the way. And the reason is that this is an incredibly risky business model. It anchors the company completely to the quality of its intellectual property. It makes it in many ways an all or nothing bet on a particular piece of science, a particular piece of technology. And it requires the companies themselves to be really good at all stages of the drug development process. They've got to be great at the lab science. They've got to be great at clinical development. They've got to even be great at commercializing their products. And very few companies are able to do all those things. At the other end of the spectrum, we have large pharmaceutical companies which produce many, many more drug candidates than they have capacity and resources to take forward. And as a result, they have to make decisions about what to advance and what to shelve. And those decisions are not easy decisions to make. It's very difficult to tell the future and the opportunity around a drug. Many of the most successful pharmaceutical products that we know today were very borderline at many points during their development. And so many big pharmaceutical companies end up taking very, very promising drugs and not taking them forward for reasons that are nothing to do with the quality of the drug and all to do with the strategy of the company or their available resources or their current prioritization. And because of those two things, we end up with an industry in aggregate that is both failure prone and which leaves good drugs on the table, which fails to fully exploit the wonderful science that we all work on. And that inefficiency fundamentally is what we've tried to tackle in Kazia. There's at least two reasons why this leaves everybody much less well off. By perpetuating these sort of inefficiencies in the system, by having this very high failure rate in younger companies, by having so much work, so much sunk cost shelved in larger companies, we in aggregate raise the cost of development of new drugs. And a figure that's familiar to all of us is that the cost of developing a new medicine is typically estimated somewhere between $1 and $1.5 billion per drug. And a fair part of that cost really represents the sunk cost of all the drugs that didn't move forward, all the ones that fell over along the way for the one drug that did get to the end of the journey. And if we could bring more of that work along, then it would dramatically, on average, reduce the cost of new medicines, change the economics of the business, and allow us to get a lot more done with the resources that we can put into drug development as a society. And that happens at a broad macroeconomic level, but it also happens in terms of specific diseases, because when you look at that cost, $1 and $1.5 billion to develop a new drug, it automatically screens out many smaller illnesses that really don't represent that sort of market opportunity. It forces companies towards what is usually referred to as the blockbuster model of drug development. We're looking for these billion-dollar drugs because those are the only ones that can really make it worth all the failures that happen along the way. Whereas if we could take forward some of these promising drugs in smaller niche indications, we could really make a much, much broader impact on society. We could treat not just the big diseases, lung cancer, breast cancer, bowel cancer, but also the much more niche diseases, conditions like brain cancer, where we haven't been able to serve patients very well to date. And so these inefficiencies in our industry, this relatively boilerplate linear way of doing things, has a real consequence for society in terms of the cost of drug development and therefore the exclusion of some very, very high need but smaller population diseases. We don't invent drugs. We don't participate at all in the drug discovery game. We have no laboratories and no scientists of our own. Rather, we go out and look for the drugs that really excite us, but which currently sit in other companies and which don't fit for their parent companies. They're not strategic. They don't fit with that company's strategy. And these are drugs, of course, that would otherwise get left on the shelf. They would otherwise never see the light of day, otherwise never have the opportunity to benefit patients. We take those drugs into our pipeline and we take them forward in Kazia. And we try to do so in a very, very different way. Instead of very traditional drug development, where we do it all in-house, all in our company, we do this through very innovative partnerships with clinicians, with academic research groups, through investigator-initiated work. We heavily leverage grant funding. And this brings to the work we do a very, very different economics from a traditional large pharmaceutical company. Typical company will allocate 100 to 150 FTEs to a new drug development program in the clinic. We have very many fewer people than that in our company. And so we're really obliged to find a much, much more efficient and agile way to do this. And so our approach in Kazia is to take these underappreciated drugs, these drugs that have not been prioritized by their parent companies. We bring to them a very, very different style of development. And we focus on doing just this one thing well, just the clinical development task. And by doing that, we look to realize the value that sits in them. We look to unlock the economics that's already been invested in these assets, but we also look to bring the benefit to patients that they represent. So we represent in a way a balancing act in the industry. We look at trying to solve some of these inefficiencies to give life to drugs that otherwise would not be economic and would not see the light of day.
We see that more and more patients today have more comorbidities, that our best pharmaceutical response is just clearly not good enough. Firstly, thank you for having me here. It's an interesting question, and it's one that's commonly asked. What's the problem Medlab is trying to solve? And the answer to that has a bit of personal experience as well as ready data today. So to take you back very quickly, I had a brother, and at a young age, he developed a neurological tumor. And during that time, a lot of emphasis from the family, myself included, was literally running around the globe looking for, let's just call it a cure. Normal to a cancer patient, Alex's condition degenerated, seizures, changes in appetite, loss of bowel function, and pain. Unmanaged pain became an everyday occurrence. And we looked around the globe. And eventually we settled on a fantastic surgeon from Texas that I brought back to Australia, and he performed Alex's first operation. And in that 8 years, Alex believed that he had beaten God. He'd cured cancer. It was in the latter part of that 8 years that Alex had a very fast degenerative reoccurrence of very different neurological cancer. It didn't matter who I went to, the chances of Alex surviving the operation became less and less. With that, Alex was on high-grade Epilum to control seizures. The pain was worse. And that's just an easy, polite way of saying it. And everything I once thought I knew about treating these type of patients kind of sort of went out the door, because there was no thick skin for this. This was right in front of me. The end of the day, Alex didn't survive the cancer. But the scary part was, in that final 6 to 8 months in particular, the cancer was probably more manageable, but Alex's quality of life had diminished to such an extent that it's safe to say there was no quality of life. In and out of palcare. He didn't want to die in a hospice. He didn't want to die at home. His pain was through the roof, to the point that he couldn't get out of bed just to do basic bodily functions. And again, you know, we were searching the globe and we were looking for the cure, and it evaded us. Alex, unfortunately, left us near a decade ago now. But Alex sort of reminded me that there are various aspects in patient care that really do need a lot more work. And it's great. You look around the globe, there's heaps and heaps of funding and initiatives in cancer. But when it comes to those comorbidities of that cancer, and so comorbidity would be pain, there's less and less. We see that more and more patients today have more comorbidities, that our best pharmaceutical response is just clearly not good enough. So we shroud this with that term of an unmet need, but it doesn't do it justice, right? You can be trained, or you can from a distance observe these patients and go, oh, you know, it's just part and parcel of that cancer. But when it cuts close to the bone, it has a very different meaning. Cancer is not one thing. In my opinion, it's a mass of different diseases. We have that necrotic cell activity that is alarming and is concerning. But it's what comes with it that can grossly diminish that patient's trajectory very quickly. If I look at the experience of Alex, it's not unusual. It's not indifferent to what we see to the vast population. When we look at pain, whether it's cancer pain or non-cancer pain, we commonly go down, what is an opioid? How is an opioid used? What are the side effects of opioids? What is that prevalence to addiction with an opioid? And these are all fit for purpose conversations. And the reason we target that is because inevitably, when it comes to pain management, and we look at that analgesic arsenal in pain management, all roads lead to opioids. The problem is we've got growing numbers of patients that get cancer. We've got growing numbers of patients that are going into pain management. Again, cancer pain and non-cancer pain. But opioids are still our mainstay. So from MedLab's point of view, the problem we're trying to solve is better patient care in these two areas. So one is an oncology area, pain, and the other is a mental health area, in order to return to patients their expectations for medical intervention. And so when we say that, we're talking a better quality of life, the ability to be human. No one wants to walk around looking like a zombie. And you sometimes see patients who are on heavy antidepressants or heavy opioids. You can see they're not there when you look in their eyes, right? They're a fragment of what they used to be. So we are trying to develop. Actually, let me say that a different way. Trying is right, but we've got very strong signals from our data. New medicines that we hope in the near term get approved and approved for use in the areas of pain and the areas of mental health. So how do we do this? Where we're different is we're not, believe it or not, looking for that next big molecule that will become that big blockbuster, right? We're not looking for that new type 1 diabetic drug, or if I may, that Lipitor type of cholesterol drug, you know, from the past. What we're doing is we're using delivery platforms to increase an efficacy of medicines, to reduce a side effect profile or a risk profile to the patient, and by increase patient compliance, which directly relates to the patient's quality of life. So one example we have of that is a program we have called Nanobus. And we're careful on how we narrate this, because at the end of the day, Nanobus is an equal part CBD THC program in this delivery platform. CBD and THC being two of the main constituents from marijuana or cannabis, call it what you will. This to us are two drug substances that when used together does have a high level of evidence that suggests pain modulation. So what that means is the ability to change how the patient interprets pain. Again, it's not a cure, it's a management device. When we look at the two together, we see a diminished side effect profile. So let me clarify it this way. Nanobus is a program that's going through clinical trials, right? We are estimating that 2024, we will have our evidence package and our CMC package at the point that we will probably be putting in drug registration, and our target regulatory agency will be the US. Today, we have in Australia around about 1,000 patients under clinical observation. So 1,000 patients. And in that category, there's a mix of cancer pain and non-cancer pain. Our best responders are cancer patients with bone pain. These typically are also non-responders to traditional opioid use. They are usually marred by the fact that they are on opioids, but their pain is still unmanaged, And the medical terminology thrown around with these patients is what is referred to as intractable pain, right? So severe unmanaged pain. In this group of patients, we've got strong data that suggests a couple of things. Improvements in quality of life. Specifically, the ones we're interested in is insomnia, so that's sleep. Appetite, so that's eating. And mobility, the ability to get out of bed and do something. We also show opioid sparing effects. So by the use of Nanobus in these patients, we can either diminish the cycle of opioids that the patient is currently on, or in a number of cases, we can actually cease the use of opioids the patient was previously on. What we also see is when we look at these pain scoring mechanisms that are used in pain management, we see an improvement in those pain scores. Now, depending on the trial programs we've run, that could be over a 6-week period. On the clinical observation work that we're doing at the moment, we've got a number of patients that have been sustainable over a 12-month period. We invest into the research. The research gives us comfort. It gives us evidence. It shows us strong signals that we're on the right track. And all this adds up to a regulatory package at the end of the day that we hope will become a mainstay, frontline, approved medicine for the use of pain. And this is just one of the unique examples that Medlab has.
We're trying to solve this issue of inaccessibility, which is ultimately what the lack of rapid prototyping boils down to at the life science benchtop, by creating an instrument that enables accessibility to biology. Hi, I'm Michael Chen, co-founder and CEO at Nuclera, and I'd like to describe myself as a scientist, first and foremost, designing products by scientists for scientists. So at Nuclera, the problem that we're trying to solve is addressed directly in our mission statement, which is to make biology accessible to everyone through desktop bioprinting. The way I like to bring that message home for everyone is by describing how other sectors have really solved that problem of rapid prototyping and fast design build test cycles. So for example, in the manufacturing sector, if you go to any manufacturing engineer and ask them what rapid prototyping means to them, they point to the revolution in additive manufacturing. For example, all of the 3D printers that you see spread around the world today, where you're able to design a part in a single day rather than the weeks to months that it used to take. In the tech sector, if you ask a computer scientist what the rapid prototyping instrument is, that's the computer that you're using to view this video right now. But if you ask a biologist what that rapid prototyping instrument is, they can't point to any tool or device at the benchtop today. And the ripple effects on anything that's bio-related or depends on a bioinnovation process at the benchtop is tremendous. From drug discovery to when I was a PhD student trying to solve my problems at the benchtop in my PhD project, I didn't have anything in order to be able to rapidly do experiments at the benchtop. And that's why it took me 4 years to finish my PhD rather than the months that it could have taken if I had a rapid prototyping instrument at my benchtop. So we're trying to solve this issue of inaccessibility, which is ultimately what the lack of rapid prototyping boils down to at the life science benchtop, by creating an instrument that enables accessibility to biology. And how are we doing that? We're starting our journey by making proteins accessible through our eProtein desktop bioprinter. we're enabling our drug discovery scientists and our scientists at the benchtop to be able to have a rapid prototyping instrument in order to get all the proteins that they need in order to complete their bioinnovation experiment or their drug discovery experiment. And the reason why we've chosen to make proteins accessible is because proteins are what is necessary in order to perform all sorts of things in our bio-based economy, from discovering small molecule drugs that are in the clinic to solve all of the diseases that currently plague human society today, from COVID-19 to heart disease, all the way to all of the items that you find in your household, including detergents that have proteins and enzymes in them in order to make your clothes cleaner in every laundry cycle that you do. So the ripple effects of our e-protein desktop bioprinter will be tremendous, I believe, to our bio-based economy and really allow the full exploitation of biology in society. What Nuclera has done is, in a strategic partnership with E-Ink, the pioneers in e-paper technology, we've created a digital microfluidic automation device, a technology that enables the manipulation of thousands of nanoliter-sized droplets in order to automate the workflows at the benchtop for life scientists. It's in effect taking digital control, the same technology that you're seeing this video on today, display technology, in order to help scientists automate their workflows at the benchtop through our desktop bioprinter. It's very simple on our e-protein desktop bioprinter. For our initial commercial launch, all the scientist needs to do is what they're used to doing in the laboratory already, except much, much faster, because rapid prototyping is our ethos at Nuclera. So all the scientist needs to do is interact with our eProtein Designer software to design the sequences that they want to express directly on our eProtein desktop bioprinter, and then order that DNA through Nuclera. And our third-party suppliers will then ship that DNA directly to our scientists. And all they have to do is take that DNA and pipette it directly into our cartridge. Once they've done that, the instrument takes care of the rest. What was a weeks to months long process that was super labor intensive, where scientists had to worry about inserting DNA into cells, taking those cells through growth and incubation, and treating those cells like they're your children, followed by lysis of those cells, breaking those cells open to create a goop that's very similar to Marmite in consistency. Throughout all that process, we've reduced all of that to a single day directly on our e-protein desktop bioprinter cartridge. In our commercial roadmap, we're initially launching an instrument that performs protein expression screen. It helps scientists get the proteins they need in order to perform their bioinnovation experiment. 5 to 10 years in the future, we are asking ourselves, if we can get that good protein for our scientists, what can our platform do in order to help them bring home that good protein for what they're ultimately trying to do, whether that be drug discovery, finding that next therapeutic, or finding that next enzyme or protein in order to help make our laundry detergents better. And so on our eProtein desktop bioprinter and our commercial roadmap in the next five to 10 years, what we want to do is to bring all of those experiments required, all of those assays required that the scientist currently uses in a system of multi-million dollar instruments and huge facilities and huge footprints and lots of labor-intensive work by teams of scientists, and put that all onto a single platform so that we become a one-stop shop proteomics workstation. And ultimately, if we're able to print all of the proteins necessary and help accelerate and make drug discovery accessible through our eProtein desktop bioprinter, why can't we directly print drugs off of our eProtein desktop bioprinter, not only in the laboratory environment, but also at home? I'm number one, a realist here, and that vision is a very long-term vision. To be able to bring that personalized medicine printer into the home. But what that would enable is the ability to talk to your doctor, have the doctor through a telemedicine format, be able to diagnose any diseases or anything that you're suffering from, and then to be able to tailor a treatment all remotely through that interaction. And then for you, without having to leave your home at any point throughout that process, get the therapies you need in order to treat any of your health conditions, in order to improve your well-being and quality of life. Investors should invest in our company because over the past several decades, the greatest area of change has been the tech sector. You can see that through the advent of smartphones, app ecosystems, et cetera. What investors now see is that in the next several decades, the greatest area of change and opportunity will be in biology and biotech. Now, the enabling infrastructures that allow for that biorevolution to occur will be the greatest sources of impact and return for investors. And what is a greater impact than a company that is trying to develop effectively a biocomputer for all biologists and scientists out there? What we're trying to do at Nuclera is remove the specialized know-how required in order to get the proteins necessary for your experiment. I like to draw comparisons to a computer scientist. We don't expect our computer scientists to be able to build every component in a computer. And this is what we're expecting of our bioscientists today, to be able to not only design the code of their proteins and their sequences, but also to plan out experiments and to do everything in order to get those proteins, effectively build that entire computer. And we want to enable our scientists and enable more people to be able to come onto the platform, do what's truly valuable, which is to code and to design experiments, and leave that know-how to get those biopolymers, get those proteins to Nuclera's eProtein desktop bioprinter.